has the same amount of pitch like it is on pinion. So whenever we are giving the rotational motion to the pinion, it is converting that motion, it is transferring that motion to the rack, and since the rack is linear, so it is actuated in the linear motion, and we are getting a linear actuation so that we can turn the wheels. So this is a very simple mechanism of gears, where basically pinion is a rotational gear and rack is a linear gear, you can say that. So that whenever we are rotating the pinion, it is giving a linear motion because of the rack. So this is a very typical example of rack and pinion used in commercial cars. And in the right hand side, you can see a very very much complicated design of a rack and pinion, where the packaging is very good and the weight of the whole system is very low. So this type of steering rack and pinions are used in normal racing cars, where we need to focus on very much weight reduction, and also we need way more performance from that. So this is how the rack and pinion steering system works. I have a video also, we can see here the rack and pinion in action. So the steering, this is a typical system used in a commercial car and you can see here there is a pinion which is connected to the rack, and then the other end it is connected to the steering column. So the steering fluids are basically used when we are using power steering, and I'll be discussing that in the next slide, how power steering works. So as you can see here, whenever we are rotating the pinion, the rack is rotating. So this is how the motion is transferred from the pinion to the rack, and the rotating motion is getting transferred into the linear motion. Now we'll be going to the last and very complex system, which is known as hydraulic and electrical actuation. So it is basically power steering. So in power steering, normally we use an engine driven pump and hydraulic system to assist the steering action. So basically the rack and pinion stays the same, or any other gearbox, it stays the same, but the driving forces that we need to drive those components is basically converted to the machines. So we are not giving the full driving power to the driver, but driver is only giving the input, and accordingly the steering fluids which are inside those valves and inside those steering lines, they actuate the rack and pinion accordingly. So if you want to learn more about power steering, you can just google it about that. I'll be giving a link at the end of the slide about power steering, and it is a very complex chapter to know to cover in this webinar. So if you want to learn about that, you can learn better in those slides, and also if you have any doubt, you can ask. Next, coming to the steering geometry, there are various types of steering geometry which a steering designer need to know, and he needs to know which steering geometry to be applied in which condition, so that their car performance will be better. Because we are race engineers, we are not commercial car engineers. So for us, performance matters most. So for getting best performance, we need to design a steering geometry which will be best at every situation. So there are basically three types of steering geometry. The first one was known as zero Ackerman, or it is known as parallel steering. So what is zero Ackerman? Zero Ackerman is known as when the both the inner wheel and outer wheel will turn at equal angle. So if you are turning your steering wheel, and whenever you are giving and turning it, rotating input, if your inside and outside wheel are turning at a equal angle, then it is known as zero Ackerman. So as you can see see at the topmost figure, it is shown here that the both the wheels are turning at an equal angle, and the line projecting from those angles are not meeting. They are parallel because they are rotating at an equal angle. So this type of steering geometry is very rarely used in some of the race cars where they need to do like that. But most of the cases we do not use this type of steering geometry in our everyday car or in any normal race car. The next comes Pro Ackerman. So what is Pro Ackerman? The Pro Ackerman is a type of geometry in which the inner wheel will turn more than the outer wheel. So whenever you are turning your steering wheel, if the inner wheel turns more angle than the outer wheel, then it is known as Pro Ackerman. And this helps the four tires of the car to concentrate on a single point and to turn about that point only. So we will be getting a very linear motion of the vehicle during a turn, and it will be smooth. And also in low speeds we need this kind of Ackerman geometry, which is very commonly used in every commercial car or in every passenger cars. So that is a type of geometry which is used in all common cars. The next thing is known as, it is good for lower speeds and small turning radius corners. So Pro Ackerman will be good if you are using the car for low speed turns and small turning radius corners, which is a very obvious case in the passenger cars. Now coming the last and the very exciting one is Anti Ackerman. So it is basically the reverse of Pro Ackerman. So in Pro Ackerman, the inside wheel turns more than the outer wheel, and in Anti Ackerman, the outer wheel turns more than the inside wheel. So basically we are just reversing the setup, and we can achieve this type of geometry by just reversing the Pro Ackerman. Here in a F1 car you can see that yes, I'll be kindly say you to please switch off your mic. So I was talking about Anti Ackerman. So you can see here how in a F1 car the outside wheel is turning more than the inside wheel. So this is a typical example of Anti Ackerman geometry, and I'll be showing you a video for that. You can see how the Anti Ackerman is affecting the car's turning angle. So whenever the car is taking a turn, you can see that the outer wheel is turning more than the inside wheel. So here you can clearly see that the driver is taking a very sharp turn, and you can see that there is a very big difference between the outer wheel and the inner wheel, and the outer wheel is turning very much more than the inner wheel. Why they are doing like this and why we need different type of steering geometries in different cars, I'll be talking about that in next slides. And we can clearly know that why we need this kind of different geometry setups in different cars. Moving on to next, there is, whenever you are talking about steering, there is a very common terms that comes into mind, which one is known as understeer, another is known as oversteer. So what is understeer and what is oversteer? First of all, we'll be talking about understeer. So what is understeer? It is basically when the vehicle turns less as expected by the driver. So basically if you are turning the steering wheel but the car is not turning accordingly, so I'll be saying that it is an understeer phenomenon. And this happens due to various factors like weight distribution, road properties and tire properties. So there are various factors which affect a car to be understeer or oversteer. I'll be showing you a video where you can clearly see what understeer is. So all the drivers who are taking this turn, there is basically a very good phenomenon acting here, that is the grip. So all of them, they are turning their steering wheels, but their car is not turning. And the very basic reason of that is they are not having enough grip at the front wheels. So it is like you are driving a car on watery surface, and you are taking a turn. So you have turned your steering wheel, and the wheels have also turned. But since there is not enough grip, so the car is not turning in the circle, and it is going straight. So it is basically, that is basically known as understeer. So we can say that whenever there is less grip on the front wheels, or there is more grip at the rear wheels than the front, so there will be understeer condition. So our front wheels have less grip, that's why it is not turning in that steering angle, and it is going straight. That is basically known as understeer. The opposite is known as oversteer. So when the vehicle turns more than expected by the driver, so suppose you are turning a steering wheel about 20 degrees, and you expect the car to be turned in a particular way, but the car turns more, so it will be known as oversteer. And this happens due to also the factors like weight distribution, road properties, and tire properties. And I'll be showing you a video where the driver giving oversteer to the car. So you can see here, the driver is intentionally giving the oversteer to the car, and oversteer and both understeer and oversteer can be changed and achieved with the car setups, with the driver inputs. So there is basically a lot of factors which is affecting understeer and oversteer. So similarly, we can say that like understeer, we have less grip on the front wheel tires. In oversteer case, we have less grip on the rear tires and more grip on the front tires. So the rear wheel is sliding anyways, and it is not getting the proper traction to that. So this is all about understeer and oversteer. You can also search more about understeer and oversteer in some of the links I'll be giving in the next slide, in the last of this slide. And you can find how interesting it is, and how you can change those factors after manufacturing a car and after building a car fully. You can also change the behavior in the sense of understeer and oversteer. And also, it is a very key factor for the driver to know if its car is understeering or oversteering, so that he can give the proper inputs to the engineers, and they can work upon that car to properly fine tune that car. There are some steering parameters we'll be talking about now. The very first parameter is caster, and we all know a little bit about caster, but I'll be explaining that. What is caster? Caster is basically the inclination of steering axis with respect to the vertical line when viewed from the side view. So if you are viewing a car or a vehicle from side view, and you see that the steering axis of that car is inclined to whichever side it may be, but it is inclined, then you can give that there is a caster given to that car. And there are three types of caster known as zero caster, positive caster, and negative caster. So positive caster is basically whenever the point of caster line, which is known as depth point, as you can see here, that is the point of the caster line is known as depth point. So basically, whenever the depth point is ahead of your vertical line point, or ahead of the contact patch of your tire, then you will be saying that it is positive caster. And whenever the both of the lines are meeting at the same point, you can say it is a neutral caster. There is no caster given. And whenever the depth point is behind your contact point of the tire, then you can say that it is a negative caster given to the vehicle. So why caster is given, how caster affects our car performance, I'll be discussing that in end of the slides. But in a general concept, you can know that the caster is given to the vehicle to increase its state line stability. So if you are giving more caster to the vehicle, so it will be very easy for the driver to make it, to keep it in a straight line. But at the same time, if you are giving more caster to a vehicle, then it will increase the turning effort of that vehicle. So driver has to put more effort to turn that vehicle during turns. So at one during the straight line, caster is very and in the turns we may not need that much of caster. So we need to fix a correct value of caster, which will be giving us much straight line stability, and also it will be giving the it will be not giving some extra amount of effort to the driver. So we need to reset that value. As you can see also here, I have given two different pictures of two bikes. In the Apache bike, you can see that there is less caster given to compared to the Bajaj Avenger. So you can see clearly that whenever you are riding a Bajaj Avenger kind of bike, you can easily just sit during the straight lines, and you do not need to put more effort to keep the bike in a straight line. But in the same time, whenever you are turning a Bajaj Avenger, you will be requiring more effort. You will be putting more effort than Apache, because there is less caster in Apache and there is more caster in Bajaj Avenger. So caster is beneficial for straight line stability, but it is also at the same time, it will also harm the turning effort of the car, and it will also be tiring for the driver. So we need to pick a very nominal value of caster, which will be beneficial in both cases, in turning and in straight line stability. Now the next parameter comes, which is known as camber. So what is camber? Camber is basically the inclination of central axis of wheel with respect to vertical axis while viewed from the front side. So if you are viewing a car from front side and the tires of that vehicle is turning like given in this picture, then it is known as negative camber. And if it is like this, like it is turning outwards, then it is positive camber. So why we need to give camber to the vehicle and how camber affects the vehicle performance, I'll be discussing that at the end of the slide. We can see a very, very particular example of camber is in the F1 cars. You have seen that all the F1 cars have been given negative camber. Why they have given negative camber, I'll be discussing that in a little bit. And but in a general concept, generally high speed vehicles are given negative cambers to get more straight line stability. So they're used to get more straight line stability, but there is much more than that, why they have given that much of camber to the vehicle. And also the positive camber is given to the off-road vehicles or the load carrying vehicles because of their functionality, because we need that kind of camber at that point. I'll be just sharing you a thought about that in the next some slides, and you can be very much clear about that, why negative camber and why positive camber is given to the vehicle. Now another parameter is known as toe. So what is toe? If you are viewing a car from a top view and you are seeing that the tires are pointing inwards, then it is known as toe in, and if the tires are pointing outwards, then it is known as toe out. So similarly, as caster and camber is given to the vehicle to improve its performance, similarly toe in and toe out is implemented on the vehicles to increase its performance or to meet the requirements. So you can very much see that how the toe in and toe out is I'll be discussing how toe in and toe out is beneficial, and at the same time it is also plays some negative role in a car's performance. Now moving on to the next, known as kingpin inclination or KPI. So it is basically the inclination of steering axis with respect to the vertical axis when viewed from the front. So if you are seeing a vehicle from front and you are seeing that the steering axis is inclined with respect to the vertical line of the tire or vertical line of the wheel, so you can say that there is some KPI given to that system. And it and the main factor, main reason of this KPI is to help in steering returnability. So as in many any of the passenger cars, you have seen that whenever you are turning the steering wheel and then you release the steering wheel automatically comes to its position. So it is because of the KPI given to that car, and that because due to that KPI, the loads act in such a way that after you release the steering wheel, it automatically comes into its original position. Now, coming to the next parameters, it is known as slip angle. So, what is slip angle? Slip angle is the difference in angle of wheel and angle of tire. So, I'll be spending a lot, big amount of time in explaining you what is slip angle, because once you get this point, it will be very easy for you to understand what is vehicle dynamics. I'll be showing you what slip angle is and how slip angle is known, why slip angle is generated. So basically, slip angle is generated because of the deformation of the tire. If you are using a steel wheel or if you are using a solid wheel, then there will be no slip angle. Okay. So because we are using a tire which is a rubber and it has some elasticity, that's why we are getting some slip angle. So whenever you are turning your tire, whenever you are turning your wheel, the contact patch which is sticking to the ground, so it tends to stay there because it is stick. It has some grip, it has some traction, and it has some friction, so it tends to stay there. And whenever you are turning your tire, due to the elastic deformation of tire, as you can see here in this photo, the contact patch is staying there, but the upper portion of the tire is getting deflected. That's why whenever you are turning your wheel, suppose you are turning your wheel 40 degrees, but your tire is turning only 35 degrees. So there is a 5 degree difference in turning your wheel and your tire contact patch. So whenever you are turning your tire, the vehicle will always follow the tire path, because the tire is the only thing that is being adhered to the road. So if you are turning your wheel 40 degrees and your tire is turning 5 degrees because of slip angle created, so there is a difference of 5 degrees. So your vehicle will be following that 35 degree turn, not the 40 degree turn, and this is caused because of the slip angle. Slip angle is a good thing, and how it is a good thing and how we can use that in our benefit, I'll be discussing that in the next chapter. And slip angle is inevitable. You cannot make a tire having zero slip angle, because that will be solid. If you are using a solid wheel, then there will be no slip angle. But at the same time, if you are using a wheel with zero slip angle, then there will be no grip. Okay, try to imagine that thing, that if you are using a solid wheel of steel, suppose you are using a wheel of steel and you are rotating it, so there is no slip angle is being created, and at the same time you are not going into the turn. If you go into a turn and turn the vehicle with a steel wheel, then the vehicle will go straight. It will not turn into that turning, because there is no grip. So slip angle is necessary for generating grip, and since the tire is having elastic property, slip angles are generated. So whenever you are turning a vehicle, the sideways deformation, in a nutshell you can say, the sideways deformation of the tire is known as slip angle, and it is different for different vehicles, different for different tire manufacturers, different for different brands of tire, and all the tires have different properties, so they will be having different slip angles according to the requirements of the vehicle. It is formed due to lateral deformation of tire. So slip angle is basically formed due to lateral deformation of tire. Next, coming to the slip ratio. What is slip ratio? It is the same thing but in longitudinal direction. Okay, so basically slip angle is the lateral deformation of the tire, and slip ratio is the longitudinal deformation of tire. So whenever you are accelerating or you are braking, the contact patch is not moving that much fast. So there is a lag in between the tire and the wheel. So if you are braking, the contact patch is getting behind the tire center point, and if you are accelerating, then the contact patch is getting ahead of the tire contact point. So it is known as that phenomenon is known as slip ratio. So these are two basic properties of a tire. So lateral deformation is known as slip angle, and longitudinal deformation is known as slip ratio. For a clear view, you can see at this picture. This is a proper and enhanced version of slip ratio, how slip ratio is created. So here, why the tire is deforming like this? Because there is enough grip at the road, which is holding the tire to be at its place. But since we are rotating the wheels, so there is a lag in between the rotation of wheel and rotation of tire surface because of the grip, because of the traction at the road. So this lag and this amount of deformation what you are seeing here is known as slip ratio. So it is basically tire deformation, but at lateral tire deformation we call it slip angle, and in longitudinal tire deformation we call it slip ratio. Now moving on to next, there are some typical steering forces that a steering designer need to know, and they need to calculate those things. The first is known as longitudinal force, which is Fx. So it is basically a longitudinal force while the vehicle is moving in forward direction. During acceleration or during braking, this force is generated, and it acts along the direction of the vehicle. So it will be in longitudinal direction. Next comes the lateral force. Whenever you are turning a vehicle, there will be some lateral force generated, and that lateral force is compensated by the tire. So if suppose you are going at a very high speed and you are turning at a high speed, so you are generating a lot more of lateral force, and that much of lateral force need to be compensated by the grip of tire. So if your tires have not that much of amount of grip, that much of traction is not available at the tires, so your car will be going outside of the turn, and it will not turn in that circle. So that is where lateral force comes into play. Your tire need to have that much of capacity to hold the vehicle at its path in its path in order to overcompensate that the lateral force generated by the vehicle. So you need to calculate the lateral force which is generated by your car so that you can accordingly select your tire and you can know which tire to use. Next comes vertical force, which is basically normal load which is acting on the tire, basically the weight of driver and weight of the whole car which is acting on the tire. It is known as vertical force. And due to these three forces, there are three moments created. So what are the moment? One, the first is known as moment due to vertical force, which is also known as self-aligning torque. So what is moment due to vertical force? See, why the moment is created? It is because of the same property which of the tire, which is elasticity. Since the tire is elastic in nature and there is a deformation in tire, so whenever the contact patch and the center of the wheel, you can see this, see at the cursor, this is the center of the wheel and this is the contact patch. So whenever you are driving a car, whether you are accelerating, braking or turning a car, so the contact patch does not always lie within the line of the center of the tire. So if the contact patch is not always at the center of the tire, so there will be a distance between the center of the tire and the contact patch. So due to those distances, various moments get created. So whenever there is a distance between contact patch at vertical direction, then we call it moment due to vertical force. Similarly, there is a distance between the contact patch and the tire center and the wheel center while a lateral force is acting. So the moment created due to that lateral force is known as moment due to lateral force. And similarly, the moment that is created due to longitudinal force is known as moment due to longitudinal. So basically, these three moments are creating because the contact patch does not lie in line with the wheel center all the time. So whenever you are driving a car, these three moments will be created automatically because of the tire properties. Now, there are some common steering problems that occurs whenever you are designing a steering system. the first one is known as bump steer. So bump steer is basically phenomenon whenever wheel goes over a bump, then the wheels will be automatically get steered. So in this video you can see, as the vehicle is traveling, the surface, there is a suspension travel, then the wheels are automatically getting steered, and we do not want this. This is a problem. We do not want this, because whenever you are driving a car, you do not want your front wheels to go anywhere. So we need to minimize this thing, and we need to achieve this by the linkage, by the dimension of the linkages. If you want to know how to overcome this problem and how to avoid this problem, you can go over internet and search at how to avoid bump steer. Then there will be many articles where there will be written how to overcome this bump steer. And it is basically a dimension problem. It is basically dimension of the link, all the linkages which are attached to the wheel and attached to the your rest of the car. So those linkages need to be at perfect dimension, so that whenever there is a suspension travel, there will be no bump steer. Now, very common steering problem we know is known as steering wheel play. So what is steering wheel play? It is basically a movement of steering wheel without causing movement of. So I am turning my steering wheel, but my wheels are not getting turned. So that lag and that free play is known as steering wheel play. So as you can see here in this video, the steering wheel is turning, but the tire is not turning. So this is known as steering wheel play, and it is a very bad thing, because whenever you are driving a race car or whenever you are driving a go kart, whenever you are doing racing, so you need quick inputs from the driver. So if you are getting this much of lag in your race car or in your steering system, then the driver cannot adjust itself to the turning of the vehicle, and also you cannot act upon that things very quickly. So driver cannot handle the vehicle very efficiently. So we need to reduce the steering play as much as possible, and so that we'll be getting more performance of the vehicle. Now that is all about steering system, how to design the steering system, and what are the parameters we need to know, we need to study before going to design a steering system. So now I have collected some of the questions that you have asked in your registration form, and I have collected some of the questions from that, and I will be answering those first in this in the slides, and after that I'll be taking the questions from the from one of you individually. Is that fine, Iftikhar? I'll be sharing the questions first in the slides, and then I'll be taking other questions.
Yeah, please go on.
Hello, are you there? Yeah, okay. So a very common question that many of you have is, what happens when steering plays more and how to reduce it? So driver will get less if steering plays more, then driver will get less feedback, and there will be more compliance between the parts. So what is compliance? Compliance is basically free play between different parts of your steering system or any other system. So suppose you are designing a steering system, then there are lot of various parts and link components involved. So we need to be sure that there is no free play between those parts. Like there is no free play between the tire and the pitman arm. There is no free play between the steering column and the steering wheel. There is no free play between the tire and the steering arm. So we need to consider these things, that there is no free play coming in between the linkages, and which will lead to the steering play more, because lag at each point will be added, and it will be creating a very bigger play, and we did not want that. So driver will basically less get feedback from that, and also compliance will be high. So how to reduce it? So if you are designing a steering system for a go-kart, then it avoid using U joints in the steering set, because universal joints are always a source of replay over the time. If you are, or if you are, even if you are using a very precision, precise made U joint, then over the time, whenever by using it over again and again, it will generate some kind of replay. So it is possible in a go-kart to avoid U joints, and you can also just use a straight shaft which is connecting your steering wheel directly to the pitman arm, and you can avoid the replay at that point. Also, you try to use high grade rod ends, which is hinge joints or other joints, so that use the very high grade joints, so there will be no free play. Yeah. So the next thing is how to use a universal joint in an assembly. Yeah, please switch off your mic. Yeah. So what are the rules for using a U-joint assembly in assembly? So I'll be sharing some of the very basic engineering rules which is better while you are using a U-joint. So first, either use 0 or 2 U-joints. So if you are using U-joints, then either use 2 U-joints or use 0. Because if you are using 0 U-joints, then there will be no steering, there will be no free play. And if you are using 2 U-joints, then both U-joints will be compensating each other. If you are using 1 U-joint, then it will create problem. How the problem will be created, I'll be sharing in the next screen. All the U-joints have to be in same phase. So what is phase? Let's see what is phase. See, this is a 2 U-joint assembly. There is 2 U-joints used here, and the upper picture is showing the correct phasing and the lower is showing the incorrect phasing. So basically the U-joints need to be at correct phase, so that whenever you are turning the U-joints, whenever you are rotating the U-joints, the power from one U-joint will be get directly transferred to the other U-joint. Otherwise, if they are not in phase, then there will be lag between the power transformation. Because suppose you have started steering at this point, and thus that rotation need to travel from here to here, and if they are not in phase, then there will be lag and there will be power loss. So the amount of effort you are giving at one end will not get transferred to the other end. So whenever you are using a 2 U-joint assembly, always make sure that the 2 U-joints are in same phase. Now, next, the angle of both the U-joints must be same. What is that? This is this. So how the angle of the both U-joints should be same? So in the second picture here, see, if you are, suppose you are giving an angle of 20 degrees to this U-joint, then make sure that the other U-joint also is at 20 degrees at the opposite of the shaft, so that these two U-joints will be compensating each other, and the full rotation motion will be transformed equally. If you are not giving same angle to both of the U-joints, then there will be a chance of power loss, chance of rotation motion loss, because they are not in same angle, they are not compensating each other equally. That's why there will be a vibration, and your driver will feel more vibration while turning the steering system, and that will create a problem. So avoid using different angles at the U-joints, and give same angles to the U-joints. And also there is a third point which is known as which is very very much important while designing a steering system. And move see at the cursor point, I am pointing at this mounting. So this is basically a two U-joint assembly, where there is two U-joints used here. One is used here and one is used here, and the middle part is supported by a mounting. So you need to focus on this thing, because whenever you are giving a two U-joint assembly to the steering column, then you need to support the middle shaft. which is not done in many of the cases in go-kart designing and also in different vehicles designing. We do not give a proper mounting or proper support to the middle part, and due to that there will be power loss, there will be rotational motion loss, and you cannot attain more efficiency by doing that. So make sure if you are using a two-joint assembly, then support the middle part with some mounting or by giving a bearing in between. That is a more that is very important point to be noted. And you can, and as you use this kind of configuration in your vehicle, you will see that your steering system will increase very efficiently. The next question is, what is better, Ackermann or anti-Ackermann? Which parameter is important while selecting geometry? So what is better? Well, they both are equally useful. We need to know how to use these things at where, so that we can use the proper thing at proper way. So nothing is more better. Ackermann and anti-Ackermann, they both are equally useful. Now next, moving on to the next question, which is known as which parameter is important while selecting this geometry. So it depends basically on tire properties like grip and slip angle. So whenever you are trying to decide whether to use Ackermann or anti-Ackermann, then you need to know your tire very well. You need to know the properties of your tire, and by that you can select Ackermann geometry is needed for your car or anti-Ackermann geometry is needed. You can also decide the geometry with driver feedback. Also, if you are not sure about, you have not very much data of your tire, and you have not studied your tire very much, so you can also do the geometry selection by driver feedback. So basically you will be first giving a Ackermann geometry to your vehicle, and then the driver will drive the car, and if the car feels good, driver is very much familiar with the car, then it is good. But if the driver is not feeling that much of confidence, then again move it to anti-Ackermann and again try. So it is a basically heat and trial method, and it is not very efficient. So I'd suggest you to go with the tire properties, and how to decide anti-Ackermann and Ackermann with tire properties, I'll be showing you in this slide. So I'll be spending about 10 minutes about explaining this picture, and from this picture you can clearly visualize when to use pro Ackermann and when to use anti-Ackermann. So this is first focus on the left hand side picture. Here it is given that Fy versus Sa. Fy is basically lateral force and Sa is known as slip angle. So whenever your tire is giving this kind of data, then you will be getting, then you can use anti-Ackermann. Why? I'll be showing you. See, there are four different lines, okay, and there are basically at different loads. So it is the lowermost line is known is having 1000 newton of vertical force, and the upper one is at 3000, 5000, 7000. So at different vertical loads, we have obtained the lateral force and slip angle values, and we have plotted that at a graph. So here, these points at the point I am pointing the cursor, these points are known as peak slip angle values. Why they are called peak slip angle values? Because at that peak, that slip angle, we are getting highest value of lateral force on the given tire load. So on the given vertical force at this slip angle, suppose for the 1000 newton vertical force, we are getting 7 degree of slip angle at a force of around 2000 newton. So we are getting lateral force, the highest lateral force at 7 degree slip angle. For the next line, we are getting that slip angle at around 5000. So it is peak slip angle for that vertical force, and accordingly for this and for this. So what we are doing here is we are joining those peak slip angle points, and we are creating this vertical line you are seeing here, which tends to going left. So if your vertical line is going left, then you can say that you will be using pro Ackermann according to the tire properties. Why pro Ackermann? Because whenever you are turning a car, your inside wheel is having less less weight, less vertical force than the outside weight. So whenever you are giving less vertical force to the inside wheel and more vertical force to the outside wheel, so here you are getting more slip angle at inside wheel, because more slip angle is generated at lower vertical force and less slip angle is generated at higher vertical force. You can see that 7 degree is generated for 1000 newton, and moving upwards around 5 degree is generated for 7000 newton. So for more vertical force you are getting less slip angle, and for less vertical force you are getting more slip angle. So whenever you are turning your car, you're obviously your inside wheel will be at less vertical force and more vertical force will be applied to the outside wheel. So at that case you can use Pro Ackerman, because your inside wheel is giving more slip angle at the less vertical force, and you are generating more grip there. Because I said that wherever there is more slip angle, there will be more lateral force and there will be more grip. So by giving this kind of geometry, you are basically forcing the car to follow the path of inside wheel, because the more grip is generated there at less vertical force. The opposite of that is known as anti-Ackerman. So whenever you are getting more slip angle at more vertical force and less slip angle at less vertical force, then you are supposed to give anti-Ackerman to your vehicle, so that the vehicle will follow the path of the outside wheel. Because whenever you are turning a car, the outside wheel is getting more vertical force because of the roll of car and because of all the lateral force that are acting to the car. So the outside wheel will obviously get more vertical force during the turn. So whenever you are getting outside wheel more vertical force, and if your tire is giving more slip angle at more vertical force, then it will be generating more slip angle, and it will be generating more lateral force, and it will be generating more grip there. So the vehicle will follow that path. So you need to give that much amount of anti-Ackerman to that kind of tire. But for this kind of analysis, you need tire data. You need to know how much vertical force at how much vertical force, how much lateral force is generated at what, how much slip angles. After knowing those values, you will be able to calculate this kind of geometry selection. Otherwise, another method is by driver feedback. So if you do not have this kind of data, and you do not have this kind values with you, you do not have the value of slip angle or value of lateral force, then just design a car and give it to your driver. Let him speak, and then you can accordingly coordinate with each other, and you can develop a geometry which is best possible for the vehicle. But the most engineering and most sophisticated way is this: by knowing your tire properly and by knowing the tire data, you can actually you can decide whether to use Ackerman or anti-Ackerman. So that is why in F1 cars, Kimi Raikkonen, some of you have asked the why Kimi Raikkonen was having anti-Ackerman. So that is why, because in most of the F1 car tires, they give more lateral force at higher slip angles, at higher vertical forces. So whenever they are turning their car, they are getting more vertical force at the outside wheel. So at more vertical force, anti-Ackerman geometry to force the vehicle to follow the path of the more grip tire. So in this case, the more gripped tire is outside tire. So that's why they're giving more steering angle to the outside tire, so that the vehicle will follow that path. Vehicle will basically follow the path where the grip is more, whether it is inside or whether it is outside. So for F1 tires, they give more grip at higher loads, higher vertical forces. So whenever they are turning their vehicle, they are getting that kind of forces. and that's why they're using anti-accrement. Now the next question is basic points to be kept in mind while designing steering system. Well, there are very common basic points, that is like steering forces you need to calculate, you need to calculate turning radius, weight distribution of your vehicle, then driver effort, how much effort you need to put to your driver, then lateral forces and tire grip for fast cornering. So you need to know the tire properties of your vehicle to be able to calculate those things. And most effectively, do a simple and effective design with very much less complexities so that you can figure out the problems later. So these are the points you need to keep in mind while designing a steering system. Now, how can we calculate the diameter of steering wheel, length of steering arm and Bateman arm, how to reduce steering wheel torque? So basically, the things that you are asking here is how to calculate the diameter of steering wheel, length of steering arm, Bateman arm. So for these things, you need to calculate the steering torque by calculating the steering torque at tire. So how to calculate the steering torque at the tire? For that, I will be giving a link to you and of a book where you can find all the formulas to calculate the steering torque at the tire. And after calculating the steering torque at the tire, you can divide it with the steering arm length, or you can divide it with the steering arm length, and you will be getting a tire force. So you are dividing the steering torque with the length of your steering arm, and you are getting tire rod force. And by multiplying again it with your Bateman arm length, you can calculate the steering wheel torque. And after calculating the steering wheel torque, you can decide the diameter of your steering wheel. And in this calculation, in these three calculations, your steering arm length, Bateman arm length, and steering wheel diameter, all these things are involved. So first of all, calculate the steering torque at the tire, then divide and multiply those things with your steering arm length and Bateman arm length, and you can also vary these values to obtain an optimum design to your cart, because you cannot give a 10 inch of steering arm to your cart, because that will be basically impossible. You need to do also packaging, so keeping those things in order to consider, so you'll be getting this kind of thing. Net, how to reduce steering wheel torque? By increasing the diameter of steering wheel or by decreasing the length of Bateman arm. So it is very obvious, you are getting, like suppose you are getting 10 newton meter of torque at the steering wheel, and you are increasing the diameter of the steering wheel, so the driver has to give less force to achieve that much amount of torque. Similarly, the tire rod force that is coming to your Bateman arm is fixed, because there is a certain amount of torque generated in your tire, and that torque is giving the tire rod force. So in order to convert that tire rod force into a torque, you need to have a less amount of Bateman arm. So if you are decreasing the length of Bateman arm, then also you are decreasing the steering torque. So by increasing the diameter of the steering wheel or by decreasing the length of the Bateman arm, you can decrease the steering wheel torque. Okay. Now next question is how to reduce the shocks faced by driver while steering on turn. So well, it is very obvious to design a steering system having least amount of complaints. So if you design a steering system where there is no pre-play between the parts, there is no complaints between the parts, then there will be very less vibration. So the driver will only feel the road vibrations and nothing else. So there will be very reduced shocks coming to the driver. So basically, design an efficient steering system having no complaints, then the driver can get no shock. Then, how to decide camber, caster, and KPA? Well, before discussing this thing, I would suggest you to first do a deep dive research in vehicle dynamics properties like camber, caster, and KPA, and how they combinedly affect the performance of the vehicle. So you cannot, I cannot directly answer how to decide camber and caster and KPA. There is no such formula. There is no hard and fast rule for that. You need to first study the behavior of your vehicle, and according to the track conditions also, you have to vary your camber, caster, and KPA. So it requires a very deep study in vehicle behavior and needs a lot of track test data. So you need to know a very much amount of data in your hand to be able to calculate those parameters. I'll give you a simple example. Like you have seen in the F1 cars that they have given negative camber to overcome that camber variation. So why they have given that kind of camber to the cars? The main reason behind that is whenever the car is turning in a fast corner, because they're going very fast and they're turning at a very high speed, a large amount of lateral force is generated, and due to that large amount of lateral force, the car rolls to the outside of the way, to the outside side. So that's why the outside tires are getting more vertical force, and the car is basically rolling to the outside whenever they are taking a turn. Similarly, since the car is rolling to the outside, their tires also rolls to the outside. So if I am running a F1 car at zero camber, and whenever I am turning, then the outside wheel will be tend to going to positive camber. There will be positive camber coming to the vehicle when I am turning that vehicle with a zero camber, because that much of lateral force is acting on the vehicle and that is creating the roll with the vehicle. So, and whenever I am getting that much of positive camber in my car, then I am losing contact patch at the rear, at the road surface. I am losing the contact patch. My contact patch area is becoming less, and I am getting less grip because my contact patch is less. I am getting less grip. So in order to compensate that, what I am doing is I am already giving some amount of negative camber to the tire. So whenever the car rolls, the tire comes from negative camber to zero camber, and I am getting more contact patch area, and I am getting more grip, and that is why F1 cars are using that much of negative camber in that vehicle. So whenever the car is turning, due to the roll, due to the lateral force of the vehicle, the tires from negative camber, they're positioning to the zero camber. So they're basically becoming from negative, they're basically becoming straight, and they're giving more contact patch to the car, and they're giving more grip, and they're able to turn go around the turn in a very high speed. So this is one example I have given you that they're using negative cambers to overcome this kind of difficulties. But there are also very other different parameters you need to know before deciding camber custom kit. So you need to have a very deep dive study in vehicle design. Also, you need to decide your driver feedback, what the driver is saying, and your lap time testing, in which parameters, in which setup you are getting less lap time, and the track conditions. Also, track conditions play a very much important role. Whenever track is different, then camber caster KPI will change. You need to change those things, otherwise the car will not behave to its utmost potential. So these are the things you need to know. Next, how caster camber and toe angle are given to the vehicle practically. So I'll be discussing this thing for the go-karts only, how you can practically give camber, caster and toe angle to a go-kart. And here, modify the wheel mountings to achieve caster. So basically, whenever you're welding your wheel mountings, weld them at an angle to achieve your caster, amount of caster you are giving. So that is a very common way of giving caster to your vehicle. And regarding camber, you need to use shims. What is shims? I'll be showing you in an example. Shims are basically thin metallic plates that are used to vary the length of your component. So how to use shims to do camber and toe variation? So here you can show. So basically, this is a tie rod you are seeing here, and these are the two hem joints or rod ends fitted to it. So if you want to increase or decrease the toe, then you need to open this hem joint to a little bit and then decrease it. So the common way of doing these things is by, if you are opening a little amount of hem joint from both the side, then you are increasing the length of the tie rod and you are giving toe in. And if you are decreasing the length of the tie rod, then you are giving toe out. But this is not a very efficient way or a very engineered way to do this, because whenever you are opening these hinge joints, you are creating much more stress at these points. Look at the cursor. You are creating much more stress at these points, because the diameter of your hinge joint and the diameter of your thyroid are not same. So the amount of force concentrated at this point is much more larger than the amount of force going to the thyroid diameter. So since there is a difference in the diameter of your hinge joint and thyroid, so you need to it is not a good practice to open this hinge joint like this and increase the length of the thyroid or decrease the length of the thyroid to give toe. So what is a better solution is this. Look at the cursor. As I am pointing to this part of the system, this is how the seams are used. So what they are using is basically they are inserting metallic plates in between thyroid. So suppose if you want to increase the length, then you can insert three or four metallic plates in between and clamp them with nut and bolts, and you can use them as a toe changer. You can vary the toe by increasing or decreasing the length of this thyroid. So to do that, you can insert more plates in between, and you can also exclude plates whenever you want to decrease the length of the thyroid. So it is basically these things how you can it is a better solution to the increasing and decreasing length of the thyroid, so that you can vary your toe settings. This is how you can practically give toe changes to your vehicle. Now, how slip angle is calculated and can steering shaft be hollow? Okay. Slip angle, if you want to know the slip angle of your tire, then you need to do tire testing. There is no other way you can calculate the slip angle and obtain other parameters like amount of lateral force your tire can hold, amount of longitudinal force, amount of moments that are creating due to the lateral force, and all these things. So you need to do a tire testing, proper tire testing, where all the sensors will obtain these values, and then you can get the slip angle values, and then you can get the lateral force values. And these are different for different tires. So if you are using different tires of different brands, then you need to rerun the test for each tire to obtain the values of slip angle and lateral force and other things. Can steering shaft be hollow? Yes, obviously it can be hollow. Why to increase the weight by using a solid shaft? If your hollow shaft can withstand that much amount of torque you're giving to the steering system, then you are free to use the hollow steering shaft. You can there is no need to use a solid shaft. And this is a picture of tire testing, how their testing is done, and the wires you are seeing here is basically connecting to different sensors which are obtaining data during the testing. They are obtaining the data like tire temperature, tire pressure, tire slip angle, tire lateral force, tire longitudinal force, and all these things they are obtaining from these sensors, and they are keeping the values and they are getting the values like that. So you need to do a tire testing if you want to obtain the values of slip angle, lateral force, and other things. That is all from my side. These are the sources I have used. Optimum G is a very famous company in vehicle dynamics. The engineers of that are very famous, and they have experience in working with F1 community. And all these things, the tire testing data, the vehicle dynamics stuff, I have done from Optimum G only. So you can Google about Optimum G. You can learn about, you can go to their articles about vehicle dynamics. You can learn very much things. And for a beginner, I recommend you to follow these two books that are Race Car Vehicle Dynamics and Fundamentals of Vehicle Dynamics. Race Car Vehicle Dynamics by Millikan and Fundamentals of Vehicle Dynamics by Thomas Gillard. These two books are very much efficient, and they are very understandable for a beginner, and you can learn much more about vehicle dynamics. So yeah, Iftikhar, that is all from my side. If there is any question, Q&A round, and anyone wants to ask any question, then we can go.
If you look at the chat box, some of the people have asked some questions. I understand it will not.
Yeah, okay, I'm looking at that. one second. Yeah, so
the workshops in the future also, maybe they will be paid, nominal fees will be there, but we'll be conducting similar workshops in the future also, so you can stay tuned and follow our Instagram page and all. So Mujit, over to you.
Yeah, okay, so I'll be answering these questions that are given in the chat box, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so here Drupad is asking that can you please show the last slide about the reference books. Drupad will do one thing. I'll ask to Iftikhar, and if possible we'll send this PPT to all of you via email, so that you can learn these things. And you can use these things.
The PPT. One thing I would like to clarify, the PPT file, which is a huge file, we are doing one thing. If possible, we'll upload the recording of this video on YouTube. You can watch it there. Anyhow, we'll email the reference books and all to all of you after this end. I'll send you an email.
Yeah.
Don't worry. Over to you.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. And Sushant is asking here for how we achieve 100% Ackerman. See, Sushant, 100% Ackerman is basically, I'll show you in the slide, so that it will be very. It will be. 1 second, Sushant. I will be showing you a picture where you can see how you can achieve 100% accuracy. Yes, Sushant, here you can see, look at the cursor.
Can you zoom in?
Yeah. So, now it is visible.
Go back, you can zoom the screen.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, Sushant, you can see here, whenever you are designing your steering system, so there is a amount of angle you can give to your steering arms, which is known as 100% accuracy. So how to do that? Simply draw the diagram of your wheelbase and track width, and then join these two points, the point from your steering arm to the rear, the middle point of the rear axle. Similarly, join from here also. So just join two lines from there, and then measure the angle between these two lines. Okay, measure the angle between these two lines and just divide it by two. So you will be getting the 100% Ackerman angle required for that vehicle. Now it is up to you to whether you want to use that much of amount of angle or any other angle. So if you want to know how to calculate that, calculate the 100% Ackerman angle, then this is the way. Just join these two lines from the steering point to the rear axle of your vehicle and measure the angle and divide it by two. So then you'll get the angle of 100% Ackerman. That much amount of angle if you give to the steering arm will give you 100% Ackerman geometry. And if you increase that angle, then it will be give you more than 100%. And if you decrease that angle, then it will be giving you less than 100% Ackerman. So that is how you can calculate the 100% Ackerman geometry. Now going to the questions. Jyoti is asking which one is more effective for off-road racing, Ackerman or anti-Ackerman. Jyoti, there is no hard and fast rule for Ackerman or anti-Ackerman. You need to have the properties of the tire, you need to have the behavior of the vehicle, and using those data you can calculate, you can decide that whether Ackerman or anti-Ackerman geometry is important for that, because it is very specific for different vehicles. So you cannot generalize that off-road racings are more effective with Ackerman or anti-Ackerman. So you need to know about that vehicle, and you need to know the parameters of that vehicle, then you can decide. Yeah. Then Surya Prakash is asking difference and relation between mechanical trail and pneumatic trail. Mechanical trail is the distance between the dead point, the caster line point, and the contact patch of a tire. So that distance is known as mechanical trail. And pneumatical trail is known as the distance between the tire center and the contact patch center while you are turning a vehicle. If you want to know more about pneumatic trail, you can also go to Google and search. Also, I'll be giving you some links, and you can read more about that pneumatic trail and mechanical trail and how they are effective for the performance of the vehicle. Ashish is asking, what is difference between camber and toe in and out? See, Ashish, camber is when the tire is turned, when the tire is inward or outward vertically, that is camber. So if you are viewing a vehicle from the front side, from the front, and the tires are inwards, then it is a negative camber. And if the tires are outwards, then that is a positive camber. But toe in and toe out is viewed from the top view. So whenever you are viewing your vehicle from the top view, if the tires are pointing inwards, then it is toe in and opposite is toe out. You can also see many pictures about camber and toe in and toe out, and it will be get clear. Sir, whether Om Vor is asking, sir, whether differential is also cause understeer or oversteer issues. I'll say that understeer and oversteer is not only affected by the differential, but there are also other parameters which affect the behavior of understeer or oversteer. So yes, differential can be a part in that, but you need to know other aspects also. Okay, you cannot say that if I am using a differential, then the vehicle will oversteer, or if I am not using a differential, then vehicle will understeer. It is not like that. You need to see other parameters also. What is the weight distribution of the car? How much grip is at the front side? How much grip at the rear end? How much drive input? How much slip angle is generated at all the four wheels when the vehicle is turning? So all these things, including differential behavior, will give you that the car is understeering or oversteering. So differential can be a part of the reason, but it cannot be the whole reason. Manas is asking, sir, when is anti-Ackerman steering used, and what are the specific application of it? So Manas, I have given one example to you how anti-Ackerman is effective. So if you have the tire data and the tire properties with you, then you can decide that whether anti-Ackerman or Ackerman is beneficial for your car. Rest, you can see the applications. Whenever the outside wheel is getting more weight, we tend to use anti-Ackerman because the tire is like that. The tire is giving more lateral force or more lateral grip during more loads, more vertical loads. So we are using anti-Ackerman in that case. But it is, as I said, if you are using a different tire and that property of the tire is different, it is giving different values, then you need to change your setup. So it is very specific to a vehicle. You need to know the tires of that vehicle, decide. And Avishek is asking, sir, which is better, gear shifting rod or gear shifter. See, obviously that is clearly up to your driver, that if he is comfortable with a gear shifter or if he is comfortable with a paddle shifter. So basically in normal cases, paddle shifter are more efficient because there is less hand movement and the time is saved. But that is economical thing, and you need to ask your driver that whether he is much more comfortable with gear shifting or paddle shifting. And yeah, Manas is asking when is Ackerman is used. Manas, I have given you the things, anti-Ackerman, why anti-Ackerman is used in F1 cars and all that. And if you have still doubts, you can ask me over the email, or you can just write to the IGC. I will be answering that. Otherwise, also you can search more about anti-Ackerman in the Google. Yeah, Iftikhar, I think I have answered the questions that is present here in the chat box.
Okay. I will just wrap up for today. Tomorrow we'll have a session on braking, brake system design. So I would like to request you all to kindly join it. And tomorrow there might be a switch in the platform that we are using. So whatever it is, we'll let you know via email and maybe via our official Instagram ID also. Whatever it is, you will receive an email by tomorrow 12 p.m. So that will be all. Thank you everyone for joining. Have a good day.